Come on, put your hands together.
I'm gonna shout with the voice of triumph, sing with the voice of praise. I'm gonna dance like I've got the victory, for my God has set me free. I'm gonna shout with the voice of triumph, sing with the voice of praise.
More than enough.
I'm gonna shout with a voice of triumph, sing with a voice of praise. I'm gonna dance like I've got the victory, for my God has set me free. I'm gonna shout with a voice of triumph, sing with a voice of praise. I'm gonna dance like I've got the victory, for my God has set me free. My God is more than enough. He supplies all my needs. He is the El Shaddai, the Prince of Peace. He is my all in all. The great I Am. He is a mighty Savior. My God is more than enough. He supplies all my needs. He is the El Shaddai, the Prince of Peace. He is my all in all. The great I Am. He is a mighty Savior. Here we go. He's more than enough.
More than enough for me.
He's more than enough. More than enough.
It's more than enough for me.
It's more than enough.
It's more than enough.
It's more than enough
for me.
It's more than enough.
It's more than enough for me.
It's more than enough.
It's more than enough for me.
It's more than enough. More than enough for me. My God is more than enough. He supplies all my needs. He is the El Shaddai, the Prince of Peace. He is my all in all. The great I Am. He is a mighty Savior. And my very, my God is more than enough. He supplies all my needs. He is the El Shaddai, the Prince of Peace. He is my all in all. The great I Am. He is a mighty Savior and my very best friend.
Come on, give me praise this morning. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. My name is Joanne Glasgow, as he said, and I was baptized at an early age, and upon that, I didn't understand salvation. So since I come into the knowledge of who Christ is, I wanted to get that experience again, so that's why I'm getting baptized today, again. Amen.
You accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes, I do.
Amen. Well, without further ado, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Well, we're super excited, Pastor. We've got three kids to be baptized this morning. Our first one is Kelsey McCamey.
Hey, just a background story of this. I baptized her once before, but she wouldn't go all the way under. So she wanted to get completely baptized. Maybe she'll do it for Ms. Donna.
Yeah. You want to share a little bit? Okay, so Kelsey, she's telling me that now that she's older, she wants to be rebaptized in can get totally under the water and to live for Jesus and let the world know who she serves. Okay, Cassie, on your profession of faith, I baptize you in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay, this is Shaylee Humphreys, and I just love this family. She is just a precious little girl, and she's given her heart to the Lord, and I talked with each one of these kids before coming up here today, and every one of them could tell me why they wanted to be baptized and what it meant to be to live for the Lord. Would you like to say something to them and tell them what you just told me out there?
My Aunt Katie had died on Monday, and if I dedicate my life to God, I will one day see her again.
In faith, I baptize you in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Hold your nose, okay? Okay, this is Aiden Jones, and I don't know if y'all have met our new nursery lady, but this is her son, so praise God. You know, we've got one that's given his heart to the Lord, and he is excited about living for Jesus. Why don't you share with him just a little bit?
I am just so happy that I get to dedicate my life to God, and I know if I dedicate my life to God, one day I will see him and everybody in my family who has passed on.
We're going to have some power-packed kids, Pastor. Yes. Okay, because of your profession and faith, I baptize you in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
All right, let's stand. Children, you guys can be dismissed with Mr. Tim. Together.
story. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Joy, perfect peace, earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive.
Life began and in the dust you formed.
This morning.
What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. the name of Jesus.
Praise this morning. If you will, turn with me in your Bibles or turn on the Bible notes to John chapter 14, verse 11 through 14. We have been here for about 4 weeks, and I just felt like I'm going to catch you up for just a second, but then we are going to get into a brand new word this morning. It says, just believe that I, and this is Jesus talking, just believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe because of the work you have seen me do. In John 14, 11 through 14, it says this, I tell you the truth, anyone who believes, say anyone.
Anyone.
Somebody say, that's me. Look at your neighbor and say, that's you. Anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done. Think about that. We're talking about Jesus, the guy who walked on water, who turned water into wine, who raised the dead, who caused the blind to see, who caused the lame to walk, who caused the deaf to hear. How many knows that's pretty cool stuff? And he says, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done. But he doesn't just stop there. He says, and even greater works. How many knows God has big plans for you this morning? Because I am going to the Father. You can ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it, so that the Son can bring glory to the Father. Yes, ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. Now, the last couple of weeks, we have been talking about this thought right here, supernatural success. Somebody say success. How many knows that God did not call you or destine you as a Christian believer to fail? How many knows He wants you to succeed in life? Whether it's in your business, in your relationships with your children or your spouse, in your church experience, whatever it is, in your education, God wants you to have success. So we've been talking about living supernatural. Last week, we spoke about our supernatural enemy, who the Bible tells us is the who? Devil, right? And so we know that we have a supernatural enemy, and an enemy that is assigned to this region, to this church, and to your life, because the Bible says that he came to steal, kill, and destroy from you. And so we have to understand that the enemy's on a mission, and he does not give up very easy, and he wants your soul, and he'll do anything to get it. But how many knows Jesus Christ has defeated the enemy? Somebody say, Jesus Christ has already won. Say it again. Jesus Christ has already won. John 10:10 says it like this. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come that they may have life and that they may have it to the full. God wants you to have a full life. A life that is full of blessings, a life that is full of favor, and a life that is full of joy that is found in Jesus Christ. Can somebody say amen? Father, we thank you for your word this morning. I pray that you bless it, speak to our hearts, change our lives in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen. Somebody shout life. Come on, guys. Say it like you've got life. Life. That's what God wants for us. Today we're going to talk about a couple of areas of life, a couple of different thoughts about life. And the first one is eternal life. How many is thankful that as a believer we have the promise of eternal life with Jesus Christ? The Bible says in Romans 6:23 in the New King James Version, it says, for the wages of sin is death. There's no other benefit to sin than death. Death is the benefit of sin, and the consequence of those actions that we partake when we sin. But the gift of God is eternal life. So the enemy comes to steal from you. He comes to kill your potential, we talked about last week. He comes to steal your success, but God comes to give you eternal life. I love the song that we sang this morning that says, Jesus, you did not want heaven without us. He died on the cross and He rose again so that we could live with Him in all of eternity, in heaven, forever and ever, because He wants relationship with us. John 3:16, the verse that we all can probably quote by heart, says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life." The word I'd like to key in on this scripture is that God so loved the world. There could be somebody here this morning that you truly feel unloved. You feel like nobody cares about you. Nobody understands the situations you're going through. Nobody understands the struggle in your life. But I can guarantee you this, that there is a Father in heaven that loved you so much that He gave that which was most precious to Him so that you could live with Him forever and ever. Watch this. John 3:36, if we read on down the chapter, it says, "He who believes in the Son has everlasting life. And he who does not believe the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him." Now, I would be doing you an injustice if I did not share with you the penalty of not believing in Jesus Christ the way we should. This is the New King James Version. I want to read to you out of the NLT this morning. That has a very accurate translation of this scripture. If you go back and read in the Hebrew, it says, "And everyone who believes in God's Son has eternal life. Anyone who doesn't obey," the last scripture said, "believe." But anyone who does not obey the Son will never experience eternal life. You see, one thing that we have gotten messed up in the church for a few decades now is that we have mistaken the word believe and what all that means. But the Bible says that if we confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that Jesus is what? Lord, we will be saved, right? It's a free gift of God. His salvation is free to us. But it says that we have to believe that He is Lord. And in this scripture, it says anyone who does not obey the Son will never experience eternal life. Here's what I want to challenge you to think this morning. Maybe this is new to you. Maybe you're sitting there and you're saying, "Well, what is Pastor talking about this morning?" I want to encourage you that the Bible tells us to believe that Jesus is Lord, not believe that He is Savior. Because Savior is a benefit of knowing Him as Lord. Can I say that again? Savior is a benefit of knowing Him as Lord. What Lord means is that He has lordship of your life. That you listen to His voice, and when He tells you to do something, you do it. When He asks you not to do something, you refrain from that. He is in control of your life. This is what lordship truly means. This is what lordship truly looks like in the Word of God. It is to obey God and to do what He wants you to do, to give Him the control of your life. You see, believing in God is never enough. James 2:19-20 tells us this plainly. It says, "You say you have faith, for you believe that there is one God." Somebody say, "One God." I love the way it's worded. It says, "Good for you. Even the demons believe this, and they tremble in terror." You know, I shared last week, you know, it's one thing to know who Donald Trump is. How many knows who Donald Trump is? Doesn't matter if you like him or not, you just know who he is, all right? You just know who he is. I know who Donald Trump is. But you know what? I don't know Donald Trump. I don't have a relationship with Donald Trump. I can't call Donald Trump up on the phone and say, "Hey, bro, I need a vacation." Number one, he's not going to answer. Number two, if he did, he'd say, "Who are you?" But do you know what that's what the Bible says is going to happen in the last day? There's going to be many who go and say, "Hey, Lord, Lord, Didn't I pay my tithes? Didn't I cast demons out? Didn't I lay hands on people?" And you know what he's going to do? He's going to scratch his head like, "Do I know you? You know what he's going to say? Depart from me, I never knew you. Because we didn't have a relationship with him as Lord. You see, we preach the Savior Jesus Christ, but many times we forget to preach the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is quick to save, man, and I'm thankful, aren't you? But he wants to know you as Lord. Somebody say, he is Lord. All right. Abraham proved his belief by actions. If you go on and read through the chapter in James, it tells us that Abraham believed that that God was the Lord of his life. That God was the Lord, had lordship over his life, because when God told him to leave everything he had and to travel to an unknown land, you know what he did? He left what he had and he went to an unknown land. When God told Abraham to sacrifice his son Isaac, whenever God told him to take Isaac and lay him on the altars, or and there was nothing for him to sacrifice, and Abraham was being obedient to God, how many knows that that proved his faith that God was Lord? Abraham proved his actions, proved his faith by his actions. And then we can see Rahab. If we read on through James, it shows us that Rahab, who was living in the enemy's camp, by the way, in Jericho, Rahab proved her faith in God by hiding the spies whenever they needed shelter. You see, faith is always proven by action. It's easy to say that we're Christians, and it's easy to say that we're believers. How many know sometimes it's harder to prove it by our actions? Okay, now look. The Hall of Faith, Hebrews chapter 11, gives us some examples of this. Abel brought a pleasing sacrifice to God, and he did that by faith because he understood what God desired. He knew God as Lord. Enoch was able to walk with God. How many knows that's pretty cool? In fact, there was a time where he was just walking with God and he's gone because he had such a close relationship with God. Noah built a boat when it had never rained. And people were saying, crazy old man, what are you doing? What is that thing? Well, it's going to rain. What's rain? Noah built a boat because of his faith. Abraham left his home. Moses left the palace, a place of authority and power, in search for the one true God. Moses left everything he had in search for God's presence. David killed a giant. Elijah called down fire from heaven. Esther approached the king, realizing that it could cost her life. But she had faith in God. The disciples left everything to follow Jesus. Stephen preached the gospel knowing that he would be persecuted and was stoned to death in the process, but it didn't faze him because you know what? He got to see a glimpse of heaven from earth. You know? And he got to experience God in all of his power and all of his majesty. Paul preached to the Romans with power and authority without fear of what they would do to him, because he had faith. You see, you've got to remember that God will say, well done, not well believed. Now, the first part of this message is we're going to lay a foundation, because until we understand the concept of Jesus as Lord, we can't have access to any of the benefits. And so we want to understand the lordship of Jesus Christ so that we can understand all that is to follow. So, Jesus will say, well done, not well believed. Am I preaching a gospel this morning that says you can earn your salvation? Absolutely not. It is a free gift laid on the table for you if you want it. However, when it comes time for you to see Jesus Christ face to face, he's going to want to see proof to your belief. Can somebody say amen? Romans 10:9 says this, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. The simple fact is, Jesus requires lordship to have access to eternal life. Can somebody say amen? Somebody shout life.
The next thing that I want to talk to you about this morning is the thought of abundant life, or life to the full, or full life, as we read in the scripture. It says, I've come that you may have life and have it to the full. John 10:10 in the Amplified. I love the Amplified's version of this scripture. It says, the thief comes only in order to steal, kill, and destroy. I came that you may have and enjoy life. How many knows that God wants you to enjoy life? Yes. Look at somebody and say, it's time to enjoy life. Look at somebody and say, it's time to laugh a little bit. Now I can show you how this works. I want you to look at somebody, look at your neighbor, and I want you to smile at them. I mean, real big, come on. I'm talking about show them pearly whites. Or those tan yellows, whatever you got, I don't know. Or the lack thereof, that can make it even better, okay? Come on now, look at somebody. We're not done. Look at somebody. Smile. What I've found, if we look around for just a minute, God has given us plenty to laugh at. Can somebody say amen? Do you know what? Do you know what? Sometimes I look at myself in the mirror and I just smile so I can laugh at myself. Salvation should be fun. Our relationship with Jesus should be fun. I don't know about you, but I had fun this weekend out at the park, goofing off. I mean, I even saw pictures of our staff riding around in the barrel train after everybody left. Waving. I don't think anybody was there, but they were waving at, I don't know, the birds. I don't know. Waving at people as they went by, smiling, having a good time. I had a good time with some guys that showed up at my we're in the process of moving, and I was busting up tile on Friday and sweating and everything. I called Pastor Quay, his benefits of having a youth pastor. I said, hey, Pastor Quay, what you doing? He always says, let me think about it. What are you asking first? No, he came over and brought donuts with him. It was awesome, you know. And then Marcus and Junior came over, and they busted up tile. And, man, we had a good time. We laughed. We had a lot of fun. Sweated a little bit. And then yesterday, Brother Robert and Brother Kevin came, and they were sanding and all kind of stuff. We had made a big mess. You know what? It's just fun. It's just fun. It's just fun having fellowship with believers. And you know what? This morning we come in here. Hey, listen, yesterday we had the Easter egg hunt. We had work going on at my house. We had a wedding. And this morning we had the brunch. I'm telling you what, this is a working church. And you know what the best thing about it is? Everybody's smiling, laughing, singing, having a good time. How many knows it's fun knowing Jesus Christ? It says, I came that you may have and enjoy life. And have it in abundance to the full until it overflows. Do you know what my Bible says? Is that He wants to give you so much blessings that you don't even have room to receive it, that it just kind of flows out of you, that you got to find somewhere to put it. And I'm not talking about stuff. I'm talking about smiles, laughter, fun, joy, peace. You know what? The biggest testimony of this church is, it's not what we've done to the property. You know, it was a blessing, $100,000 remodel on the property. That is a blessing. And the staff, that's a blessing. But the greatest blessing of this church is that every time I sit down with a visitor, they say, I love the way it feels here. Yeah, give yourself a hand. They say things like, it feels right. I feel peace here. I feel joy here. Every single time. Yesterday, 3 or 4 people told me that. This morning, several people have already told me. You know, it just feels good here. Listen, that is God. When God is doing something in you and is so awesome that it just flows out of you. To where, you know what? Those in your workplace start to notice it. And those in your home start to notice it in your community. And they say, man, there is just something going on with you. What is it? Point to Jesus. It's all for His name's sake and for His glory. Now look at this. God wants you to have a life that is overflowing with all of life's goodness. We need to be excited about what God's doing in your life. I love being around people who are just, oh, Pastor, I got to tell you a testimony. Miss Teresa, the other day, yesterday, I was at the wedding, and she's in the kitchen preparing and everything, and she says, oh, Pastor, I got to share a testimony with you. My son, whose name is Sean, was diagnosed with cancer. Miss Teresa's son was diagnosed with cancer a few weeks back. And they called it what they thought was too late. And they were saying it's stage 4. There's not a whole lot we can do. There's not a lot of hope. And so he goes to the oncologist. And the oncologist looks at all the reports and does some testing and things. And says, you know what? I think they were wrong. I don't think it's stage 4 cancer. I think it's stage 2 cancer. And it is very curable. She's excited. She's full of life to tell the testimony. And then her next words out of her mouth is she said, I don't serve a God who does things halfway either. One day he's going to be cancer free. Can somebody say amen? Be excited about what God's doing in your life. Jesus paid for our wholeness. He paid for it. When he died on the cross, he didn't just die for your sins. He died so that you could be full of life, so that you could be whole. The Bible says this in John 5, verse 6, it says, when Jesus saw him lying there, if you read the story, he's lying on a mat. He knew that he had been now this way for a long time in that case. And he saith unto him, wilt thou be made whole? That is a profound question in the Word of God. Wilt thou be made whole? Do you know what God's asking today? He's saying, hey, you want wholeness? Or do you want to stay in your broken state? Because we in the world are broken. We're missing the thing that makes us tick in our spirit. We're lacking in these things. And God's saying, hey, I'm here to make you whole. You know what? I sense in my spirit there may be someone here today that you've just had a hard month. You maybe have had a hard year. And you just feel broken inside. You feel broken inside. I'm telling you that God brought you here today to make you whole again. God does not only care about your spirit. He cares that you enjoy your life here on this earth. Can somebody say amen? Wholeness simply means this. Nothing missing. Nothing broken. That's the kind of life that God desires for you to live. Isaiah 53 verse 5 says, but he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins, and he was beaten so we could be whole. God wants us to be whole. Can somebody say amen? Amen. 3 John 1:2 says, dear friend, I hope all is well with you and that you are as healthy in body as you are strong in spirit. God cares about your body. He cares about your mind. He cares about your soul, your emotions, all of those things that make you tick. You know why? Because he loves you. Look at somebody say, he loves you. God did not die so that you could be healthy spiritually, but suffer in life. God died so that you could be made whole in every way. Somebody shout life. The third thing that I want to talk to you about today, and it's the final thing, is resurrection life. 1 Corinthians 15:4 through 7 tells us this. He was buried and he was raised from the dead on the third day. That is why we celebrate today. Can I tell you, we don't celebrate bunnies and eggs. We celebrate a risen Savior. We celebrate a Savior who is alive and well, who the enemy thought he had beaten, but he rose again with power and authority in his hand. It says, just as Scripture said, he was seen by Peter and then by the 12. After that, he was seen by more than 500 of his followers at one time, most of whom are still alive at that time. They're not today. All right. Though some have died. Then he was seen by James and later by all of the apostles. You see, when the enemy thought he had won, Jesus had just begun. Can I say it again? When the enemy thought he had won, Jesus had just begun. I think he's worthy of praise. Can you give him praise this morning? But before he won, he was laid in a tomb. Some of you may have found yourself in a tomb experience. And a tomb experience is not very much fun. But I truly believe that it's time to allow God to shine light on your situation this morning. Go ahead. One thing I know about a tomb, is that a tomb is dark. Amen. Y'all okay?
Yes.
Make me a little nervous. A tomb is dark. Can you imagine the grief that was going through the minds and the hearts and the spirits of Jesus' mother, his brothers, those who loved him, those who followed him, knowing that Jesus was in a dark tomb? Some of you may have found yourself in a dark experience in your life. That's what we're going to call the tomb experience this morning. The second thing I know about a tomb is that a tomb is lonely. One thing that I know in life is that there are times where you feel very lonely, where you do feel like there's no one around, that no one is listening to you, no one cares. When you pray, it seems like God is not listening. There may be somebody here that you even feel like God doesn't even care about you anymore because you feel very lonely. The third thing I know about of a tomb is that a tomb is quiet. God, where are you? I'm going through darkness in my life and struggle in my life, and you're nowhere to even be found. You know what Jesus said the day that he was crucified? He said, "Father, why have you forsaken me?" Tomb experience is very quiet. And the fourth thing that I want to talk to you about this morning is that a tomb is hopeless. There's no way I'm going to make it out of this situation. There's no way things are ever going to be the way they were. There's no way that I'm getting out of this. There's no way. There's two words that can change your tomb experience. The words, "But God." The words, "But God." You know, I was thinking about the tomb experience this week and thinking about how it must have been when the ground began to shake and the stone began to quake and a little bit of light began to shine in the midst of the darkness. I also thought about Lazarus when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, and he had been in the tomb and he had already begun. The Bible says, "Stinketh." And Jesus said, "Hey, roll that stone away." Can you imagine whenever there was complete darkness and the stone began to just barely move and the first shine of light began to come into that situation? I believe with all of my heart that God brought you here today to shine some light in the midst of your darkness. Can somebody say amen? I've got something to give you this morning. Brother Robert, if you can help me real quickly. Brother Kevin, we're going to do this in just a second. We've got a small gift for you this morning that we want you to keep to remind you that no matter how dark life gets, God's light is still there. You see, God can shine light in the darkness. Brother Robert, Brother Kevin, they have a small gift they're going to pass out to you right now. You can go ahead, guys. It's a tea light. On the bottom of this tea light, you'll find a small switch. When you receive your tea light, if you would please flip the switch on, we're going to let you take these home, and I want you to put this somewhere just as a reminder that no matter how dark it gets, God's with you. God is with you. You see, God can shine light in the midst of your darkness, because what we find out in the Word of God, that it is when things are the darkest that God's light shines the brightest. The Bible says that you are the light of the world. Why are you the light of the world? It's because you are housing the light of the Word of God lives inside of you. That means there are people around you, in your workplace, in your neighborhoods, in your marketplaces, in this town, that need to see the light of hope. They need to see your light shine. You may be the only light that will ever shine in their tomb experience. Somebody say, I'm the light. God can shine light in the darkness. Number two, God can bring hope to the hopeless. With God, there is no such thing as hopeless. God is the hope to the hopeless. And can I tell you this? You are someone's hope. You carry the answers that they need. You carry the hope that they need in their situation. You are the hope. If you are here this morning and you feel hopeless, I can promise you that there is hope with Jesus Christ. And the third thing that I want to talk to you about today is that God can bring life to the lifeless. God can bring life to the lifeless. If you're here today and you say, you know what, I just feel dead inside. I don't even get what you're talking about. I'm telling you that God can bring life to the lifeless. God will shine His light in the midst of your darkness if you allow Him to. If you allow Him to. You know, all of us know someone who is in a hard spot. All of us know someone who needs a little encouragement. All of us know someone who needs to experience Jesus Christ in His power and in His authority. Not just in namesake, but in lordship, so that He can transform and change their life forever. We house the light to shine in someone's tomb experience. One of the questions I'm going to ask you today is, will you let it shine? Will you let it shine in the midst of darkness? Will you allow God to shine through you in the midst of someone's darkness? The one thing that I found out about the tomb experience is the tomb experience is usually where the victory is won. Amen? Do you remember Jesus Christ died on the cross? He breathed His last. The enemy thought that it was finished because Jesus said it's finished, didn't He? But as soon as He left this life, they placed His body in the tomb. The Word tells us that He descended into hell, took on the devil and all of his authority, took the keys to death, hell, and the grave, and won the victory once and for all. Can I tell you that whatever struggle you are going through today, whatever battle you are facing today, whatever tomb experience you are walking through this moment, your battle has already been won. It wasn't won on the mountaintop. It wasn't won on the easy days. It wasn't won on the good days. It was won on the tomb days. You may be saying, why am I having to go through this? I remember Pastor Quay said one time in a message that your setback might just be a setup for a blessing. Amen. Your temporary setback may be a, hey, listen to this, permanent setup that you are going to win a victory that will sustain you through this life. Amen. Your tomb experience has greater value than you will ever understand if you will allow God's light to shine in the midst of darkness. Thomas, could you turn this light down for me real quick? If you have your light, would you hold it up, please? You know what the greatest thing about being a Christian is? You are not alone. Amen. The Bible tells us that there is no struggle that you're going through that others in the faith have not walked through as well. Whenever it seems like there's no hope, you have other lights that can shine with you. Can I tell you that's why it's so important to be plugged into a church? Hallelujah. To have a church family. That way when you're walking through a tomb, you're not walking alone. Amen. The enemy wants you to be isolated, but God wants light to be multiplied in your life. And when light is multiplied, you can light a room that is full of darkness with a simple tea light. Look around you guys. That is awesome. That is awesome. That is the light of Jesus Christ. That is to shine brightly in any tomb situation. Aren't you thankful that He's risen this morning? Somebody give God praise. Would you stand?